different ideas about reform when I started, David Crombie being the mayor. We actually went through a recession in the late 80s and early 90s. We had the boom years, we had amalgamation. I'm going to talk a bit about city planning, about city building. And so we'll kind of touch on that on the basis of kind of 1974 to 2010, 2011. Rachel is helping me. Thank you very much. And let's start. Rachel, next, please. So again, just the themes of reform, recession, boom. Next. So reform. 1974, Crombie was elected in 72, and a reform council was brought in, and it was quite a different, fresh start and rethinking of what we were doing in the City of Toronto at the time. Some of it was a reaction to a lot of intensive development at the time. If that sounds familiar, maybe it is. And lots of things were happening. Next. So, 1970, the first BIA, Bloor West Village. Many of you may know it. Nice, beautiful shopping area on Bloor Street West. As I said, Crombie was the mayor. 1976, the central area plan was passed. And I'm just going to comment on that for a minute because it was actually a very important piece of Toronto's history. And the reason was that at the time, and partly by the way of the thinking in the planning department at the time and the mayor and others, parts of the downtown and the central area were zoned only for commercial uses. You could not have any housing at all. But there was this emerging trend at the time, and the thinking was that there should be a mix of uses, that in fact more people should be living in the downtown. And there was a big fight over it at the Ontario Municipal Board. And the development industry, or a lot of people in the industry, believed that you had to preserve important parts of the downtown only for commercial uses. Well, that was resulted in a very long OMB hearing, and the result was the city's view prevailed. And I think in many ways, you go back to 1976, that it led to the health of the downtown today. That in fact, what we see with consequences, that there is an impact from all the building that we see. But we see a mix of uses. We see the residential uses downtown as well as the commercial uses. And it's really led to a downtown that has activity night and day, a lot of people living and working there, and quite a different downtown than I think would have resulted if we had not prevailed with that mixed-use idea. So along the way, in the life of cities, you'll see some pivotal moments in time, and I think that was one of them with the Central Area Plan. Spadina Subway opened, 1978, Fred Davis was the mayor, and there's an interesting little story around that. That was when David Crombie went to, I believe, federal politics, and they had to have a mayor, and depending on how close it was to the next election, you could actually appoint the mayor. Council had the ability to appoint the mayor if it was a certain time period before the next election. And Fred always wanted to be the mayor, because he loved the ceremony, but I think the implicit understanding was, Fred, you can be the mayor, but we're not going to let you do anything important. And that was fine, because Fred didn't mind that. Fred just wanted the office. 1980, John Sewell becomes mayor. Toronto Planning and Development Department merged in 1979-1980, and that's when I became shifted from Development Department to the Planning Department. Next, please. A little thing about neighbors and neighborhoods. Stop the Spadina Expressway, Jane Jacobs, very famous person in terms of urban activities and influence on urban life, very important. And in a way, it's also a reflection and a reminder that cities evolve sometimes in very important ways when things aren't built. So sometimes it's what we build, and sometimes it's what we don't build that influence how a city develops. And in that case, of course, it was the Spadina Expressway coming south from Eglinton where it ends today. And that would have gone right through the annex neighborhoods and everything right down. If the entire expressway plan, which was devised in the 40s and 50s, had been developed, there would have been a crosstown expressway. And the Spadina would have come right down, connected to that, and connected to the Gardiner. So you can see, or envision, what kind of a change that might have made to the city of today. And so, as I say, sometimes city building is about what you don't build and what people in the city want and how they influence it. Next, please. This is just a little reflection on where I actually started in 1974. It's a neighborhood called Dovercourt Park neighborhood. And it was a nice little stable neighborhood, but it needed some improvements, it needed some rethinking, it needed some resources. And so at the time, the federal government, the provincial government, Metro Toronto, and the City of Toronto all put money into these programs, and they were actually called neighborhood improvement programs. And in a way, it was a response from what had happened before with places like Trafan Court, where they had gone in and demolished entire neighborhoods. This response was much more fine-grained and much more about working with the local communities to do things that they wanted rather than demolishing entire neighborhoods. It was an interesting experience for me because it allowed me to learn more about the city, to interact with people, and it was, in a way, a good way to start a career as a civil servant. Next. So you can see that's me in the middle there. I was actually young at one time, my hair was darker, but things changed for all of us. There was lots of activity at the time, a lot of community involvement, and a lot of staff working in neighborhoods and working with neighborhood groups. Quite different than what we see today. Next, please. So you can see the planning board had 12 site offices, if you can imagine. 12 different offices across the city working very closely with neighborhood groups. Today they don't even we don't even print a directory because it's so big. It's all online, of course. Next, please. So neighborhoods, you know, the heart of many cities. Certainly, we've always seen Toronto as a city of neighborhoods with a whole lot of variety to it. On the lower right there, A&E Records, for those of you who might remember Yonge Street and A&A and Sam the Record Man, how that's changed over the years. The old style streetcar. In fact, we're getting our brand new streetcars. I think they're rolling them out in 2014. So all these things change over time. But the fundamental part of Toronto is we still really think about preserving and protecting our neighborhoods. Next, please. St. Lawrence neighborhood. Now that is looking east from Yonge Street. And you can see the Flatiron building in the middle there. The Flatiron building is still there. It's a historic structure. It's probably been part of yours over the years. Beautiful building, and it has that public art on the end of it, which happened over time. And that area in front of it is now Bertie Park. That was developed in the 70s, and it used to be a parking lot. And the St. Lawrence neighborhood, you can see beyond the Flatiron building, empty parking lots, some old industrial buildings. The notion was that they were going to develop a whole new community with a whole mix of incomes where people could live downtown in an affordable kind of way. So that was the beginning and another outgrowth of the reform movement at the time, which was how do we develop and how do we build social housing? Next, please. Also, business improvement areas. As I mentioned, the first one was Bloor West Village, established about 1970. And you can see there was a whole bunch of them. I think there's 70 or 80 of them across the city now. But there was a number of them in the former city. And the idea was that small businesses, not malls, but small businesses, wanted to contribute money to their own areas so they could improve themselves, attract customers, and those kinds of things. And it really was a response to things like the Eaton Center in Yorkdale and those kinds of places. Next, please. So Bloor West Village, as I mentioned, that's Alex Ling down in the lower left corner. He's still involved today. Quite an evolution. Greektown, that's fine, go to Greektown. Greektown, actually, it's just a way that things change over time, which is Bloor West Village had no specific ethnic characteristic, if you like. Greektown, of course, the name says it all. Became a destination for Greek restaurants, people going there for that kind of experience. And it became what I would call kind of an ethnic kind of business area. So it had a different take on it. Now, of course, we have Taste of the Danforth. We see how these things evolve. And we see how our local business areas survive in today's world of big box, malls, all those kinds of things. And their response was offer something different, build on your strengths, and offer a level of service and neighborhood compatibility. Next, please. Urban design. Now, urban design is a word you hear a lot about today. It's about how you think about city planning in a way that doesn't just talk about the design of a specific building, which is really more about architecture. It talks about how you put buildings into an urban fabric. It talks about how you relate buildings to another. It talks about how you use public space and how street and road networks are part of the fabric of a city. That debate was going on in the 70s. And that little article, which was in a city planning publication, was done in about 1970. 1978. And Ken Greenberg, who is now quite a noteworthy consultant in Toronto and has worked all over the world, actually wrote that article, and he was commenting on the difference between how the official plan of 1969 treated design issues and how the plan of, I think it was 74, treated design issues. And the thinking in the earlier days, in the 60s, was we're going to do massive big block developments, you know, where they eliminate lanes and fine-grained parts of city making, and do great big plazas, you know, like the bank plazas, things like that. In fact, you probably recall or know that, except for the activism of citizens, we wouldn't have the City Hall today, because that would have been part of the Eaton Center. So the thinking in the 60s was, let's do these massive developments, let's do these big block kind of developments. That changed over time to start to people thinking about how they're going to work with the existing fabric of the city. Yes, we had a recession. And when I was in the planning division as the chief planner or director, I would remind people that notwithstanding how busy it is today and how the pace of development is quite frantic in some respects, we went through a recession when almost nothing was happening in the city. And it was a very quiet time for planning, so we turned our attention to other things. But one of the things that did happen in that time, I think it's the latest slide that shows it, is we actually had an office building developed at the northwest corner, northeast corner of Yonge and Queen. That was pretty exciting for us. Next, please. So you can see what was happening along the way in that time period. Subway extensions were happening. Art Ableton was elected as mayor. Art was one of the longest serving mayors, I think 10 or 12 years. Scarborough RT opened in 1985, which is really interesting because now, as part of our transit expansion and our transit revitalization, the RT will be replaced by an LRT as it becomes part of that build-out for the Eglinton LRT and replacing the RT. But 45 years later from building the Scarborough RT to replacing that technology. So see how long it takes in the evolution of cities to build and renew ourselves. Next, please. So that's what I'm saying, that's the office tower at Yonge and Queen. It integrated the facade and a little bit of the interior of an old bank building with the new office structure. Housing on Main Streets. We did quite a lot of work on studying what was going on Main Street. So your typical two or three story building. Did a lot of work on it, did a proposals report. Unfortunately, it didn't really go anywhere substantially, and probably for a number of reasons. One is, we had parking standards that didn't really work with development. You couldn't really develop these small buildings because the parking standards were too high at the time and you couldn't provide parking. As you probably know, many of these buildings are owned individually anyway. It's hard to consolidate sites. So there's a lot of good kind of ideas behind housing on Main Streets in terms of how you could redevelop and intensify in a very kind of appropriate way. But however, it met up against a lot of real obstacles that kind of prevented it from happening. Planning and the economy touched on the fact that we went through a recession. You might recognize in the top left-hand corner the stump of the Bay Adelaide Center. That stump was there for 20-plus years. Along the way, though, in fact, right at the beginning, they delivered the public benefit on the right side as a cloud building. That was actually part of the public benefit of that development. Bay Adelaide was meant to be a very big commercial office development, and it had heightened density that was not permitted by the bylaw. And so there was public benefits that were going to come out of that. And the Cloud Garden was one of them. So we actually got all the public benefits. But it took 20 years for the economy to come back sufficiently and the office market to come back sufficiently in the downtown to actually build the office towers around it. Now we're kind of into the boom years, which I would say, in my experience in the city in terms of development activity, kind of started in around, I would say, the late 90s. And really continue today. I mean, I just retired in March, the end of March of this year, and my four and a half years of chief planner, 4 years, six years before that, we've been on just an incredible cycle of investment and activity in this city. And it's been quite remarkable. Next, please. So you see Art Surveyor, then June Rowland, Barbara Hall, Spadina Streetcar opens, Spadina Subway is extended. The interesting thing is, in many ways, we had some successes in transit in terms of our ability to build and add to our transit system. But we've also had times when, in fact, we made no investment in transit. The problem with transit is it's very expensive, it's very complicated, and it takes a long time to execute it. And if you don't have a good plan, and if you don't finance it over time in a predictable way, you won't get a robust transit system. And we're in that problem right now. You know, the recent debates at council over should we do LRT, should there all be subway, what are we doing about that? So we actually did do transit investments over time. And then I think, 10, 15 years of a time period in which there really wasn't much investment in transit, and we're paying the price for that now. Next, please. Just a little note on development that happened at that time. The Greenwood Racetrack, Queen and Woodbine, very controversial. I was actually quite involved with the planning of that. People from the neighborhood say, well, it's the beach neighborhood, it's very special, what's this new community going to be like? One of the results was talking to the people who developed it when it was finally approved there, and there was a lot of people from the surrounding neighborhoods actually moved in there. They were tired of renovating their older houses, want a brand new house, and the neighborhood served that purpose. But the other part, the lower part of the slide, just has the kind of map of the area where the Gardner Expressway used to have ramps that came down all the way to Leslie. And those ramps were taken down partly because they actually weren't needed. They weren't required as part of the Gardner functioning. I know we have a lot of debate, or have had debate over the years about should the Gardner stay or should it be taken down. But the ramps were a much easier transportation decision, but still very controversial in the neighborhood. I would go to public meetings and people would say, you're crazy, they would be right in my face, you're crazy to even think about taking down the ramps. And now, of course, we've taken them down. The results have been quite good. It's opened up the area in a whole different kind of way. People, I think, sometimes have to see the reality to understand the impact of those decisions. Next, please. And there's been interesting provincial influences, most recently with the provincial Liberals, the passing of the Greenbelt and Growth Plan. They've had a big impact on the city. And in my experience, my time with the city in planning, we were starting to see developers who previously had done virtually no work in the city. They were mainly greenfield developers doing lots of low-rise housing out there. And they were starting to look at the opportunities in the city, because the Greenbelt legislation and the Growth Plan prevented major development from continuing out with the sprawl type of development that was happening. So you can look at some of that, how the percentage of GTA housing starts that we had, the share of starts in the region outside of Toronto shifting to apartment type structures. All of those have been really fundamental changes in how development's happening. And it can really demonstrate how things like provincial legislation can have an impact on the city of Toronto. Next, please. Torontonians moving downtown. We did a study 3 or 4 years ago. And interestingly, at that particular time, a little snapshot, you can see those, the green and the blue area, a very high percentage of the people that were living in high-rise structures had moved from another part of the downtown. So that was just an interesting snapshot at the time. And people, by and large, like living in these buildings. They like living in high-rises. They enjoyed the advantages of them, and we just wanted to understand better who was living there and for what reasons. Next. Development transit, of course, it isn't all about high-rises, it's about townhouses, it's about modern houses in existing neighborhoods, it's about mid-rise buildings there on the right. So we see a lot of different development patterns in the city, and that will change over time as well. So amalgamation, there's a slogan, Toronto runs with Mel. Mel Aspin, the mayor, kind of amalgamation. This fundamental change in the city, a real change in culture, political cultures, planning cultures, all kinds of different cultures in terms of how people felt about the city, how they didn't like or they did like amalgamation, the benefits that it was supposed to have, a number of which never came to happen. But it was a very controversial time. I think it's taken, amalgamation happened in 1997, 1998. It's taken quite a few generations and elections for people to, I think, get used to the idea that amalgamation is a reality, and how are we working with amalgamation, how has it impacted us. Next, please. And one of the ways it impacted us as planners is, you know, we're now in this great big city, and this is a view of looking from the north down and back into the city, rather than thinking about it as a city outward. Sometimes you have to think about it from the fringes of the city looking back in. The new official plan was adopted in 2002. Shepherd Subway opened over to Don Mills in 2002. Lots of things still happening in amalgamation. Next, please. Boundaries, rules, and tools. Just a, you know, the city was divided west, north, far east, and south. And those are kind of administrative things. They kind of, in some ways, reflect political boundaries, but for administrative purposes in the planning division, that's how we divided our city, and that's how we administered it. Bylaws, and I'll get, we're just going to talk a bit about the zoning bylaw in a minute, but there are something like 43 different zoning bylaws in the city, and that's because every municipality had its own bylaws. Scarborough had, I think, 26 of them, because as they built new communities, they would have new bylaws adopted. Next, please. So post-amalgamation, the reason I have this map is it gives you a bit of a sense of what we call urban structure. The purple areas are employment areas. The green areas are all the parks and river valleys that run through the city. The brown areas are what we call avenues, where we expect to see development happen over time along our arterial roads. We have transit, reasonably robust transit along them. And of course, the downtown, the waterfront. In red are the centers, Scarborough City Center, North York, Yonge and Eglinton, Etobicoke City Center, and also development happening there. And someone asked me, you know, what's the effect of the official plan? Well, the official plan said we wanted to have development happening in these places. And if you look at, you know, when we've done the numbers and looked at it, something like 80% of the development that's happened since the official plan was adopted happens in those areas that are designated for growth. Next, please. So city planning and its influences and the kind of things we look at. Next, please. We have the zoning bylaw project, which was actually adopted by council in 2010. Very controversial, because we were trying to bring 43 zoning bylaws into one. And in addition, it was adopted at the last meeting of council in 2010, and then they had an election in the fall. And so there was a lot of outcome over trying to adopt that new zoning bylaw. And in fact, we had a lot of problems with it, candidly. And we had so many problems that in 2011, council repealed the zoning bylaw and said, you've got to go away and fix it. You've got to figure out how to make these problems disappear and then bring it back when you fix it. Now, I've left, but I know the team is still working on it, and we'll be bringing back a new zoning bylaw in the fall of this year. So, if you just go on to the next one, part of how we had to do that was in 2011, the staff team met with 600 of the 694 people representing appeals. Actually, that's 694 appeals. The result was there were about 150 people to meet with, because many lawyers represented a whole number of clients. But the new bylaw will actually be improved. It'll have a better transition. It won't be so hard for people to go from the old bylaw to the new bylaw. I know this is all absolutely fascinating, but it's a bit of the technicality of what goes on in cities. Next, please. And we're also looking at the five-year official plan review. And that involves things like, what do we do with our employment areas? What do we do with our housing? Do we have enough affordable housing? What about our heritage plans and our policies? We need to update all of that. So the five-year official plan is quite an important thing to do. The provincial law mandates that we do it every 5 years, and that will be finished, we think, around about the end of 2014. Next, please. And design panels. Design has become a really big focus for many parts of the city. We have our own design review panel. Toronto Community Housing has its own design review panel. Waterfront Toronto does. And they work in a way that architects, engineers, professionals in the field actually volunteer their time. We don't pay them. They sit about once a month and they review significant projects and they offer their advice on those projects. And they're actually taken quite seriously. Developers who come in front of design review panels, they listen carefully to those comments and they generally modify their projects to be more in tune with the comments of their professionals in the field. So they're a very important part of our planning process and how things get built in the city. Next, please. The city ecology. We live in a city built up lots of asphalt, lots of concrete, lots of buildings, but the ecology that exists in the city is also very important. We're here in May. April and May are incredible times of bird migration across the city. We're right in a bird migration pattern. And so we have bird-friendly development guidelines. So when people build tall buildings downtown, we want them to treat the glass in such a way, we want them to have their lights off at night. All those things that help migrating birds. We want to be able to treat our stormwater on site in a lot more ecologically friendly way than we did before. We have a green roof bylaw that mandates a green roof on buildings of a certain size, typically bigger buildings over six stories. And there's been a number of those built. And they help in a number of different ways. One is they treat stormwater that comes down. They allow for ecology and habitat for birds and insects. And they actually mitigate the heat of the building because that green roof itself means that the local little microclimate around the building is a little cooler than the surroundings because it absorbs heat in a different way. Next, please. We're also doing and have done work on mid-rise buildings because although people think, we're all about Toronto and tall buildings and those kinds of things, and that's what you typically see downtown where the land prices are the most expensive, we also expect that over time we're going to see a number of mid-rise buildings. When I say mid-rise, I mean buildings that are, I would say, between 6 to 11 stories tall, and it depends on the width of the street. So on a street like Queen Street, which is a much narrower street than something like Shepherd Avenue, you might see a new building being built. We would say at around six stories, 5 to 6 stories. When you go to Shepherd Avenue, where the street's a lot wider and can accommodate a taller building, you might see 10 and 11 story buildings. And that's because we can't just live in the future with one building type. It can't all be about tall buildings. We need to have different types of buildings. So we look at how we build these mid-rise buildings over time. Next, please. And in downtown, we've kind of gotten a little more sophisticated about our thinking around tall buildings, and we've got rules around how they build tall buildings, what the setbacks should be, where they should be located, and how they should contribute to the urban fabric. Next, please. On the mayor's tower renewal, the present mayor would actually not say it's his tower renewal. This was actually the previous mayor's tower renewal. But it's all about how we do a number of things with these aging and older concrete tall buildings that are all over the city, built from the 60s, 50s, and the 70s, often a place of affordable housing for people, often big part of a community, but there are a lot more energy hogs. They were built at a time when they didn't worry so much about energy costs. So one of the ideas was looking at how we can retrofit those types of buildings, make them more energy efficient. And another part of it is how can we integrate them better in the community and actually give people in those buildings an opportunity to create their own business in the building. So there's a lot of those initiatives which are just playing out over time. Next, please. Another one is vital signs monitoring the health of cities. Michael Chansky works at U of T. He's done a lot of research on this issue and found that there were some really significant trends happening, one of which was that lower income levels in the city were growing, and in fact, we're moving outwards from the city to the north and east. Higher income areas were also growing, and mostly in the central part of the city, in the desirable neighborhoods and in places where accessibility to transit was really good, and that the middle class was shrinking. And those have a lot of implications, and although we as planners can't necessarily solve those problems, we have to think about the impact of them. Because one of the things you have to think about is social cohesion and how do cities function with different groups? How do people feel part of the city? How do they feel comfortable in the city? So we have to be very mindful of those things over time. because we've seen examples, you know, think of London a couple of years ago, riots in the streets, people burning cars, those kinds of things. Sometimes those things happen because social cohesion is breaking down. So you have to be mindful of that. Next. So city building, I just want to touch on a few things that contribute to city building. Next, please. One is the public realm. Young Dundas Square, the work that's going on, if you go down to Union Station, you can see all the construction happening there. That's going to be a magnificent restoration of that beautiful building. It is, Union Station has more people traveling through than Pearson Airport does every year. It's the single most important transportation hub in the whole region. And they're expanding the subway platforms. GO Transit is upgraded. There's going to be a green roof as part of it. They're restoring the historical aspects of it. And they're going to be redoing Front Street in front of Union Station. Maple Leaf Square, south of Front Street, you go down Simcoe, the new underpass under Simcoe under the rail lines that was opened up a couple of years ago. That's led to a whole rethinking of that part of the city. Port Royal is just a part of the Etobicoke city center. So the public realm and how we treat our open spaces and places where people interact, very important part of city building. Next, please. Open spaces like our parks and our features like Sugar Beach, the charming little beach area developed over by Red Path Sugar, H2O Park right down in the central waterfront, West Day, and how we're going to rethink Queens Quay, and we're going to see a lot of work on Queens Quay this year. Reorganizing and rethinking Queens Quay and the central waterfront. So how we think about our open spaces is also a very important part of city building. Next. And cultural landmarks, we've been very fortunate to have a rebirth and revitalization of a lot of our cultural landmarks here in the city. Right on Dundas, the one done by...
Okay.
Who's the architect? Frank Gehry. Exactly, Frank. So we see things like that, which really, a lot of it done without any money from the city. A lot of it's done by private money, or in some cases, provincial and federal governments. The Opera House, designed by Diamond Schmidt right there, Queen and University. All we're thinking of that means we have to put a street network back in place. We have to have mixed use and mixed income in the housing. We have to have a mix of social housing and market housing. And all of that's been happening in Regent Park. Lawrence Allen, which is up at the Allen Expressway and Lawrence Avenue, if successful, will also revitalize itself. Not in the same way as Regent Park, it's a different location, it has different kind of constraints, but the fundamental principles of mixed-use neighborhoods and strong public connections to open spaces and surrounding neighborhoods, those kinds of principles will happen in Lawrence Allen as well. West Donlands and the Pan Am Village. You can see it's got to be finished by 2015 because it's where the athletes are going to stay. So they've got the builder selected. You can see 1999, 2000. We hope that's what it'll look like in 2015, that it'll be the athletes' village. And when it's finished, because the Pan Am Games are pretty short, right? 2 or 3 weeks. And then after it's finished, it'll become market housing. So sometimes you look at city building as being done through the motivation of international games and big events. And that's why people like the Olympics and things like that, because it gives cities an opportunity to reinvent themselves. Next. That's just more illustrations of what it is, but I think the important things about the fact we're doing the village in the West Donlands and the waterfront Toronto is doing all that planning is because it gives us an opportunity to rethink our relationship to the river, the Don River. And the fact we're going to have neighborhoods close to the river, I think it's important in how the city thinks about the river and thinks about itself and the river. Typically, Toronto, if you think about it, ignored its waterfront for many years, partly because it was mostly industrial, had rail corridors and transportation corridors running through it. And it ignored its rivers. And we have these beautiful rivers, the Don River, the Humber River, major river systems running through the city. And it takes a long, long time for people to start thinking about that again. And how do we relate to the water around us? So things like the Athletes Village and the West Donlands, all the work that we're doing down on the waterfront, I think help us to start to reconnect to the natural systems around us. Next, please. Water. water infrastructure. The reason I put this slide in here is because we take for granted a lot of the infrastructure in the city. We just think, yeah, we're going to have power forever, we're going to have water forever in the sewage, and it's all going to be looked after. Meanwhile, of course, we're adding, in the last 5 years, about 20,000 people a year to the population of the city. We're adding buildings all of the time, and we're starting to stress our fundamental infrastructure. And the Toronto Water, which is part of the city that is responsible for supplying clean, fresh water to us, as well as looking after all the sewage, is doing a very major study, mainly related to the waterfront area. Because what they're finding is they're starting to run out of capacity. But in fact, the ability for the city to absorb new buildings and new people in those kinds of areas is starting to run up against the limits of our ability to basically process sewage, quite frankly. Water is not such a problem. We probably will be okay in terms of fresh water, but we're going to have to think very carefully about how we upgrade our sewage capacity over time to account for all this new development. Next. So that's a boring machine. I don't mean boring as in it's not very interesting. Boring in terms of it's going to tunnel right through parts of the city, partly for the Eglinton Crosstown, because a lot of the Eglinton Crosstown LRT is going to be underground. Come from about Keel Street to about Laird. And the reason is the street right away is too narrow. You can't put them on the surface, there's not enough room. You have to put them underground. Once you get out of the ground at around Laird or East Keel or a little bit west of there, you've actually got room on the surface for them to exist. But these machines are incredibly big, expensive machines, but they work their way right through the soil. They can go up to about 25 liters a day when they're really working well. I was involved in the oversight task force for the extension of the Spadina subway, which is going to end up in Vaughan. And so I got familiar with the terminology and how these things work. But they're a very big part of, particularly the Eglinton Crosstown, which is underway right now. Next. So we'll just talk about that for a bit. Planners are now doing a lot of study on it. Segment 1, Segment 2, Segment 3. So they're starting to the west, because that's where the tunnel boring machines have started. And they're working east. And they're looking at all the land use issues. They're looking at the opportunities for intensification. They're out there meeting with the public right now about the opportunities for neighborhoods that can improve, neighborhoods that can be developed all along the corridor. Because one thing we know for sure of our experience in planning is that major transit investments will bring development activity. There's no question about it. So it's a very important part of not just building the transit system itself, but also doing the planning as we go along. Next, please. So you can see land use designations. Some of the land use along there are stable neighborhoods. Some of intensification and mixed use, some as employment areas, a whole range of things. Eglinton corridor will cross through 14 different wards. There's a lot of different politics along the way as well. Next please. You can see a whole lot of different building types, some of low density housing, mid-rise, retail strips, a whole lot of different building types that are there right now. Next please. So I just want to show this because this is, when you get onto the wider parts of Eglinton, around Don Mills, they're actually a 36 meter right of way. And typically you can accommodate the LRT in the center. You can have two lanes of traffic, you can have a bike lane, and you can have a generous sidewalk. So they actually can work. And I think what we have to do in Toronto is we actually have to build it and show people it's gonna work. Because we can't afford to build subways everywhere. Subways are great, but they're very expensive, very intensive. So I think this demonstrates, and in fact, with the right kind of right of ways, you can have a really good high capacity LRT system. The other thing about LRTs is, we really have to distinguish between them and streetcars. LRTs are a much higher capacity kind of system, and they work at a higher speed than a streetcar does. Next. So you can see different kinds of streets and sidewalks along Eglinton. Some of it even, tree-lined and leafy retail strips, very busy intersections. All kinds of different typologies and activities have to be taken into account when we're planning for it. I just want to end with this on city building. I don't know if any of you read the Globe last weekend, but they had an article on R.C. Harris. He was the Commissioner of Public Works for, I think, something like 30 years. Absolutely remarkable. You never see it today in terms of a senior civil servant being in that position for that long. But he was responsible for things like the Waterworks building, which has been part of Doors Open, out at Queen and Victoria Park. Fabulous Art Deco. I mean, it's just a stunning building. And I've been fortunate enough to be in it a few times. He was responsible for the Bloor Viaduct and the fact that they made allowance for a subway before we even had a subway in Toronto. Very far-thinking kind of bureaucrat. But as the article commented, belonged to a very different generation of bureaucrats who saw city building as a project not to be done in 3 or 5 years at a time, but a generation at a time. And we have to remember that the investments we make in city building have to be durable and sustainable, but they often take a long time to do. Meanwhile, we're in 4-year political cycles, right? Every 4 years, council gets reelected. Everybody wants immediacy and they want, you know, quick results. We have to remember sometimes, results on major city building don't often come quickly. Next. And thinking forward, I'm just going to run through this quickly, but there's lots of people that influence city life. Spacing Magazine, Tim Jones and Culture, the mayor, developers, the environment, business people, activism, philanthropy, all of those things influence how city life happens in the city. Next. So thinking forward, governance and decision making. That's actually me sitting on the ferry coming back into the city. It's one of my favorite views, because you get this beautiful view of the city. But governance and decision making, we have community councils, right? We have council committees, community councils. Every, you know, period of time we have to rethink that, because they only work for a certain period of time and the city changes around them. So we have to think about our governance models. We have to think about city building and how we do that and how we change our thinking about that. Next. Civic engagement. How do we actually engage people that work in the city? I mean, we have public meetings. You know, social media has really consumed the way people interact with each other now, but yet cities are very slow to adopt those kinds of mediums. You know, we're very uncomfortable with a lot of that stuff. We don't know how it works. So we have to rethink civic engagement as we go forward. Transportation and transit. If there's one theme I tell people is that you've got to have a transit system that's well-planned, well-funded, and well-executed. We cannot throw the city on road capacity anymore. Transit is the only way we're going to go forward as a city. Next. The environment, as I say, and as I pointed out in my slides, although cities are a lot about built form, cities are also about the environment around them and the ecology and how we interact with it. Next. So, we have all of these things to think about as we go forward. Cities change. There's challenges for all of us. And that's it. I'm happy to take questions.
On the timelines, you highlighted different mayors.
Yep.
How impactful is the office of the mayor when you talk about generational rather than policy shifting every number of years?
Right. So, sorry, I'll put this back on. Mayors are very important in cities. And the reason is, a number of reasons, but one of them is, they are the spokesperson for the city. With 44 councillors, one person has to speak for the city. And that's really the mayor's job. So, I think there's a, and you pointed out something really interesting, which is, you know, how important is a mayor? How big an impact does a mayor make? And they can make a big impact. But how do they also do that in the context of seeing 20 and 30 years forward and not coming in and deciding they're going to change everything? Because quite frankly, some things in the city, you just can't change in 4 years. It's not going to happen, and you shouldn't try. So the mayor, I think, has to balance those things. And a good mayor has to think about the long term, what's going to happen 20, 30 years from now, and the shorter term, which is, what are the citizens, what did they elect me for, right? Why did I get elected? What was my platform? But good mayors will think about both of those things and find a way to navigate through those political waters and bring council along with them. Good mayors have always done that. I mean, it wasn't like David Cromwell didn't have an easy job in 72, you know. He had, you know, a number of supporters and a whole, you know, I can't remember how big the council was at the time. I think it was around somewhere between 18, 20 people at the time. But he had his opponents. But he had to find a way to work with all of them to take the city forward. So it's the mayor's job is really key to do that. And they devised that plan after the Great Fire. Right. A lot of the city burned down.
and I think it was Burnham that did it. And they had to have a plan for how to rebuild the city. And they envisioned a waterfront, not entirely, but a lot of clearer buildings, right? Like very kind of open to the water, to the lake. And they stuck with that plan for like 100 years. We never had that plan, number one. So fundamentally, we started from a different place. We did, however, I think, start from the idea that we wanted to connect people to the waterfront. And that's been hit and miss over the years. If you come in west from the on the Gardner, and you go by Humber, we call it Humber Bay Shores, it used to be called the Motel Strip, I used to work out of the Etobicoke office. That plan for redeveloping that area was devised probably in the 80s. It had to go through an OMB hearing and everything like that. So they always had a notion that it was going to be redeveloped. And when I worked out there, people would say, well, why do you allow these big tall buildings to be built? I can't see the water anymore. And one of my responses was, you actually have to get out of your car. And it isn't, in my view at least, it isn't about just driving along the expressway and seeing the water. It's about getting down off the garden and actually walking around Humber Bay Shore. It's actually quite delightful. So part of it is, we never had a plan that said we're going to have a waterfront that's open to views from the Gardner. That really was never part of the plan. But we always had a plan that said we want people to live close to the water. And I think it has impacts. One of the impacts is you have to get to the water and think about it in a different way. It's not something you're going to be able to see easily from the Gardner anymore. And that's just the reality of how we've developed differently than other cities.
But there was a, David Crombie had his waterfront plan, and he was promoting the waterfront, but,
yeah.
And the Olympics had something to do with it, and trying to get the funding to do it at some point.
Yeah.
But somehow, it may be there, maybe just I'm not aware of it.
Yeah, Crombie was part of a waterfront regeneration, as a trust, I think it was called. And you know, part of it was connecting different parts of the waterfront with bike trails and walking trails, some of which is happening over time. But it was never, you know, it was always about how do you do that while we're building out the waterfront. I think what Waterfront Toronto's done is very good because they've had a high quality of design and they've done the public realm first. Like if you go down to the foot of Sherbourne and Queens Quay, you'll see that brand new park, Sherbourne Commons. And they built that before the development happened because they knew that if you really want to do it right, you need high quality public features. But in a way, it's also about you actually have to experience some of this on foot or by bike. You kind of have to get down there to understand it. I think, and it'll be mixed. I mean, not everybody likes it because some people still think, you know, we've gotten, even if you got rid of the garden, there'd still be a wall of condos. But I think my view is you actually have to appreciate it as a place where people live and work and just see it in a different way. Buildings, if they're a big building. Shangri-La, I actually just walked by there the other day. It's quite a remarkable piece of public art, actually. It's hard to, you can't miss it. Now, some of it is more subtle than that. So for instance, if you go to Bay Street and go past the new Bay Adelaide buildings there at Adelaide on the east side of Bay, their public art is actually a light display inside the building. If you go by it at night, you see all this interesting lighting going on. So sometimes it plays out in different ways. Sometimes it's a really bold sculpture, like that dragon kind of sculpture at Shangri-La, and sometimes it's lighting. Sometimes it's just a more subtle installation. But yes, we still do.